I'm not running, I just don't feel like I'm taking good photos. And if I'm not doing photos, then my running doesn't seem to be feeling right. It's like I've got to seek a adventure, seek a sunrise, sunset, and take a few snaps at the same time.
Kia ora tato. That was Kunal Kumar. I'm Matt Raymond.
And I'm Eugene Bingham.
This is Dirt Church Radio. Interesting conversations with interesting runners. Hot news.
Hot news coming. Can't say it yet.
Wild challenges.
Can't say it.
Well, we can talk about wild challenges though.
Can we?
You've got to give something.
Yeah.
You've got to give some tease.
Yeah.
Yeah, some enticement. Planning? Some. Yeah.
What are you thinking?
I have no idea what they could be.
Mel's promising something.
Yeah, so.
Wild challenges coming soon.
Wild Things sponsor Dirt Church Radio fantastically well.
Well, they do it really cleverly.
Yeah.
Because they do it in a way that they get something.
Yes.
We get something.
Yes.
But listeners, you get something as well.
You get something.
Because if you use the code
for nothing.
DCR2020, you get 15 months as a VIP member for the price of 12,
mm-hmm.
which gives you access to a bunch of stuff.
Such as?
A bunch of stuff. Kunal Factor stuff.
Kunal Factor, Trail Directory. The shop's pretty impressive. The
shop's pretty impressive. Get good discounts. But you can get in the draw for heaps of entries.
Yeah.
And, yeah, coming soon, some news about wild challenges too.
And, you know, regardless, I actually went on to Wild Things today mm-hmm. on the Book of Faces and mm-hmm. Spread some right-wing propaganda. No, actually, I was asking a question about a headlamp, but what I was doing, what happened was just the community's awesome.
Yeah.
Like, you can ask any question.
That's the thing.
And you're going to get a variety of very helpful answers very quickly.
And heaps of people used that code last month.
That's awesome.
It's great.
So DCR2020 at wildthings.club.
.club.
.nz. Yeah.
No. Just .club.
Jeez.
Yeah. And listen out for news about wild challenges.
Wild challenges.
Yeah.
That's what we do. We chip away at things. These ads take us hours. This is you need to know that this is the cream of the crop, people.
Take 47.
Scott shoes carry us over hill and dale. They are comfortable and hard wearing and I mean, I get about 1,000K, like, and legit, I don't care if other people don't. I get about 1,000K a pair, which is good value. And
I get my little Strava alert things going.
Time for new shoes. Get new shoes. Yeah. But they're fantastic. So we're running in the Kinabalu Ultra RC at the moment. And I really like the Supertrack Ultra. That's what I wore on the weekend. That's what Saiwan wore on the weekend. Stick like glue to anything. Durable. And just a good time. Really looking forward to going to Kepler and using the Scott Kinabalu RC. I know that there's some new stock coming in, you know, with all of everything's been happening in the world. I think Grant's been a little bit low on stock, but he's getting an inrush.
Got containers.
He's getting a containers yellow and arriving. Black wave.
Mm.
It's going to arrive. And if you go to scottrunning.nz, you know, get hooked up with all the goodness. Scott Shoes. Proud sponsors of Dirt Church Radio.
Is he going to be down at Kepler?
He's going to be down at Kepler.
With a shop?
With a shop.
Who else is going to be there?
Rocky's going to be there. Mel's going to be there.
Oh.
We're going to be there, so you're going to get Scott
We've got a
running.
Shop down there, right?
We're going to have some stuff down there.
We're going to have some merch down there.
But you're going to get Scott, you're going to get Ultra Spire, you're going to get Further Faster.
Jalbo.
What?
Jalbo.
Jalbo, yep. The sunglasses, you're going to get.
Somebody banging your microphone.
Banging a microphone, you can get wild things, and you're going to get us there doing our live show, and we're going to have a fantastic panel. There's going to be some amazing elite runners there. It's at 4:30 at the Fiordland. I've just banged the mic to it, the Fiordland Recreation Centre. And for those of you listening from overseas for the first time, yes, the ads are always this terrible. Anyway, if you go to keplerchallenge.co.nz to get really jealous about the fact that this is an amazing mountain race that we're going to have.
Mm-hmm.
And it goes something like, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go to further, faster, now.
Oh, further, faster, there in Christchurch. Rocky is hairy and so is Badger. Jules is nice and Jacob is delicious. Go to further, faster, now.
Church Radio.
I think in the annals of documenting adversity, if Kunal had been here to take photos of the fight when we realised that your mic wasn't actually plugged in for the intro that we just had to re-record, it was compelling.
There were moments of terror.
Joy when we found out that your mic wasn't plugged in.
Yeah, that was the reason we couldn't hear me. Anyway, episode 119.
We made it.
We made it. You get to episode 119, you realise you need to plug your mic in to actually record anything. Yeah, anyway. Good times in the forest again yesterday. Yeah, that was good to catch up with Saywan and Bruce Meyer.
Yeah, Bruce Meyer, that was cool.
DCR listener, we saw him twice. We saw him again.
Oh, really?
Looping around. Yeah. He was certainly fired up.
Yeah, he was full of the joys of spring, wasn't he?
He was. It was great to see you, mate. But boy, those speedsters, the old rally cars, they made a real difference to the place.
They made a real difference to the place, absolutely. So there was the Rally of New Zealand went through, or Rally Auckland, one of the two. There were some very fast cars driving through Riverhead on Saturday morning, which would have been compelling as hell and not entirely they would have been terrifying. Some of the, you know, coming up over the trig and Spinlays Road at, you know, 100 miles an hour would have been
cornering and
quite fast. And whooped out all the gravel too. So
Yeah, there was like mountains of gravel on either side, isn't there? And even you noticed the camber.
Yeah, camber's completely changed. Absolutely.
Yeah. Anyway, so we share the forests.
We share the forests.
We do. So speaking of sharing the forests, Kunal Kumar this week he does an amazing job of that, doesn't he?
Absolutely.
He's a runner, but he's a photographer who really shares the story of running and the story of the places that he gets to so beautifully.
Yeah.
And he's also just a total, total good sort.
Yeah, absolutely. And we've been wanting to have him on the show for a while because it's something that, now more than ever, you know, everyone is an amateur photographer with, you know, smartphones and stuff. And we wanted to ask him, you know, about his life, how he got into running and why he loves and loves about documenting, but also how to take a good running photo. Not as difficult as you might think.
No, and I also insulted him by asking how to take a good selfie. So you can look forward to that as well. yeah, apparently. I didn't know that. Oh, I should have known that. Of course I should have known that. Anyway, he was a wonderful, wonderful chat with him. Looking forward to bringing you that. How have you been, man?
Yeah, I'm good. I am. I'm looking forward to Kepler in a couple of weeks. I'm really looking forward to it, and I didn't recognize how much I was looking forward to it until I thought on Friday that there was some chance that we would get put into level two again, and I wouldn't be able to go down to Te Anau. But other than that, yeah, I'm really enjoying the process, and it feels like this year more than any other year the race is going to be very much the cherry on top. So I am stoked.
You've been doing some good backing up runs, you know, doing some doubles over the weekends. How have you found those?
Really good. I mean, I'm coached.
It's been hot.
It's been hot, although I'm going out early, so it's not too bad. But yeah, you know, Coach Scotty Hawker is just treating me very, very well. And it's, I was saying to you before, it's nice to be engaged in the process but actually not have to worry about what I'm doing, to trust the process.
And it's
working. But yeah, no, I feel this, you know, today I feel very, very tired. I had to do a full day of teaching today and I was like, I've got to stand up all day. Oh my gosh.
And now we're standing up podcasting.
That's right. So,
and it's past 9 o'clock. It's past my bedtime.
But it's been fantastic. And I'm hungrier than I've ever been as well, which is saying something because I'm a hungry man. But here we go. I think the challenge is, after the race, is going to be going to have to sort of write myself notes.
We've sort of got this tradition of beer and chips, or in my case, non-alcoholic beer and chips after the race. So we're going to have to stock up really good, aren't we?
Yeah, absolutely.
Fresh choice beforehand.
Yeah, fully.
Yeah.
And you, what about you? I mean, it was so nice to see you and Saywan again.
Yeah. And, I really enjoyed that run. It was a good run. Lots of laughs, lots of sharing moments.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it was great. But yeah, it's been a busy old week. And I've been enjoying some strength and balancing work alongside my running and riding. I've still been doing a couple of rides a week, which has been good. Yeah, it's sort of getting some of that the sort of base bedded in again, ready to bounce into things. But really looking forward to getting down to the grunt. Looking forward to that. I'm quite excited by it, actually.
Mm.
I didn't realise that I actually had a bit of a sense of dread about Kepler.
Right.
Because, about taking on the 60K.
Right.
I was sort of, because I knew in my heart that I wasn't prepared, but now I've made the decision to do the grunt. I'm really excited and I'm looking forward to it. I'm excited. Mm.
It's one of the things that Kunal talks about as well, which I think, I commend his... He has a sense of purpose and backbone that I might not, because I am one to kind of go with the FOMO of, oh, I've got to go to this race. I've got to get engaged with it. I've got to do it, And
really?
Yeah, I fully do.
Do you? I see you the opposite.
I'm just disciplined. I just choke it down.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So my plan is, yeah, my plan is choke the FOMO down, choke the FOMO down. Yep. Choke the FOMO down,
right.
and then I get to 65 when I can enjoy races and then have a stroke. That's my plan. It all comes out of the toothpaste tube and then you can't bang back.
Good plan. Mm.
No, it's not as bad as I thought. I'm actually not like that anymore, but I remember, yeah. I did used to feel that.
Right.
Like, we've got a whole lot of friends who are preparing and really excited about running, Tarawera and 100 miles. And I just... don't want any part of it at all. I feel so happy just to be like,
not be doing that.
You do it. Yeah. Go
yeah.
for it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But yeah, there we go.
Hey, let's just do a quick shout out to our Patreon patrons.
Absolutely.
If you like to support what we do, we'd love you to come on board, but we don't expect it. And we really appreciate those of you who do. So thank you so much. And we are grateful.
We're on patreon.com/dirtchurchradio and we've got some cool stuff coming up and coming down the pike too, so
yeah,
stay tuned for that.
Indeed. So you kind of mentioned this, Matt, with the prospect last week of, oh God, are we going to go back into lockdown? Because we had another COVID scare in Auckland last week. On Friday, many of us were sort of anxiously waiting to find out if a case of community transmission, which had emerged, could be traced back to its source. Otherwise, it looked like we'd be heading back into some sort of level two or three lockdown. Boy, it was a real worry. But it's also a reminder that there are plenty of other people around the world who are still dealing with this pandemic.
Absolutely.
On a scale that we just can't imagine down here. And the truth is, until we get a vaccine, it looks like we'll be on that sort of, on the swing, weren't we? On tenterhooks, standing guard for any more outbreaks. So I just think it's a reminder, isn't it? Please, please, please use the COVID Tracer app. Wash your bloody hands. And if you're not well, stay home. They sound really, really simple, but they're so, so important. And, just have a look around the world and see what can happen when things don't go right.
Well said.
Mm.
Yeah, well said.
All right. So a few races on around the country this week.
We've decided that we're going to focus on a couple.
Give us a bit of feedback.
Give us a bit of feedback. We like the idea of, We
want to support local races.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But we don't want to turn this into the equivalent of the shipping news.
Yeah, exactly. Shipping news is great, actually.
Absolutely, shipping news is great.
But Wild Auckland at Pea Hut looked like a stonker of a day. It was hot as buggery, and that sand would have been so hot and so heavy.
Yeah.
And those hills.
Yeah, absolutely. There was the part with the chain, which is the part that we didn't find.
Yeah.
But Sean helpfully had a marshal at the bottom going, no, it's up there.
No, he really does want you to go up there.
That's right.
Which is what we missed out that time.
So the 19K had 730 metres of vert, and Mari Manger won the women's in 2:17.20, which is no joke.
Yeah. But look at the mix in that men's race.
Yeah.
Holy moly. It was a lineup, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. So Jamie Piggins was first across the line in 1:39.24. Andreas Romanis, second in 1:42.05. And Tom Hunt back in third, 1:54.43. Mm. So there's some hot. That's a sharp point.
A whole bunch of talent there.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But every race was so steep, wasn't it? 13K had 400 something metres of vert. Robin Lesh won the female in 1:28.20, and Teddy Esther won the male in 1:15.40. And the 10K, 300 metres of vert. come on. Megan Moore 1:14:23 and Nathan Richards 1:11:59.
And that's, I mean, those trails out on the west coast at Piha, if you're lucky enough to get out there, they really are something special.
Yeah,
they really take no prisoners.
Yeah, yeah. So the extra Wellington West Wind, which is at the Meridian Wind Farm, some great trails up around there, and they opened it up for this race. So in the long course, Tom Peck won it in 1:43:12. But get this, three women in the top 10.
Awesome.
So Deborah Lynch, Emma Peschini, and Nicola Hankinson were 4th, 9th, and 10th overall. So get it.
That's awesome.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So good. In the medium course, it was Stephen Woodwork in 1:05:07, and Laura Jackson kicking it in at 1:15:46.
Yeah. And in the short course, Walter Somerville, 29:10, and Laura Green, 32:37, in 2nd. Oh. And first female. So there you go. But look, we got a little message.
Yep, from Fiona Hayweiss.
Yeah, yeah.
About her son Spike.
Yes.
So my son, who's 8 years old, he ran 3 of the 5 Xterra Wellington events this season, the short courses, which is 6 to 7 kilometres, each time crossing the finish line first under 16. Mostly he was the youngest runner out there. The overall placings were at number one. He was at number one at Red Rocks, which is his home trial, so not the home ground.
Oh, no, no. So he was 18th.
Ah, right,
that's
I see.
The number one race.
Yeah. Number one race at Red Rocks, 18th. Yeah. You can take this. This is too good. My brain has gone to mush. So Mikiros,
he was 6th, and West Wind Farm 11th. So he, so real proud mum moment.
Absolutely.
No wonder with those genes. So yeah, no wonder you're proud, Fiona. So look, the New Zealand 24 Hour Champs were on over the weekend as well. Looked like some pretty decent distances run there. And we just wanted to give a special shout out to previous DCR guest Dawn Tuffrey, who was 2nd in the women's and 3rd overall with 196 kilometres.
Yep.
And Mel Aiken, so she ran in the 6 hour and she did 45 Ks before an injury stopped her short. I didn't know that she could get injuries. She's unbreakable.
Well.
Yeah. Get well soon, Mel, and we'll see you out there racing soon.
Damn right.
And get this, finally, the A2E, the Ashurst to Esplanade, which is a local race in the Manawatu with Kate Southern. And another
the running lady.
Former, yeah, another former DCR guest. Amazing race director. So they had a record turnout this year. And get this, I got in touch with Kate to say, hey, can you send us the results? She's like, no, we don't do results.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, we're all about the fun of the race. So yay for you. Oh, that's just it's awesome. It's so good.
That's so good. That would be really challenging for some people, I think.
I imagine it would be. Yeah.
I know with
River Because it was just an assumption of mine. It was absolutely. Like, hey, where's, I can't find
where's
the
race results, mate?
Kate, I can't find the results. Where are they, mate? You know?
Yeah. I know that we at Riverhead Rampage, we don't do medals on purpose. And every year someone asks for a medal. And my thing is, if you really want one, I'll make one for you.
But. And some stuff in the bush.
It's, oh no, like CDs. Like I made one for Dave Jacket. It has CD on it, and like it was, yeah. But it's with love. Lola crocheted one last year for someone.
Oh,
had
nice.
A chicken on it.
Ooh, you're gonna have people asking for them.
Well,
you better shut that down.
Well, if you really want one,
okay. All right.
Greatest run ever, which is the part of the show where we ask you to write in and tell us your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be a race or a mountain summit. It might just be a run around the block, something that's sung to you for some reason. Send it in to us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. And this
well,
is from
that you were 8 and you went spectacularly fast at.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Anyway,
you had an awesome first name as well. Nathan May writes, and kia ora, Eugene and Matt. I grew up in the foothills of the Waitakere Ranges and spent most of my weekends as a teenager hiking in the hills or surfing at Auckland's west coast beaches. As such, ever since I first heard about people running the Hillary Trail, I loved the idea of one day running from one end of my backyard, the Waitakere Ranges, to the other. So back in early 2018, with the looming Rahui due to Cody dieback and the prospect of the trails being closed, my best mate Alistair and I decided it was time to give it a go. Due to a string of injuries, namely a recurring slipped disc that seems to prevent me from running for 6 months at a time, we decided to split the trail into 5 separate runs and run it over 5 weeks. This particular run was our 5th and final run. The plan was to run from Whātapu to Piha. We'd run the other 4 sections over the previous days and weeks and were excited to get it done. The day before, we checked the weather forecast and saw that it was likely to rain at some point on Saturday afternoon. We weren't too worried but decided to start early just in case. So there we were at 10 a.m. the next day at Whātapu Beach.
So early.
Millennials at Whātapu Beach lacing up our trail shoes and picking the smashed avocado out of our teeth. No, and beginning the last leg of our adventure. We had a great run out of Whatipu, taking in the sights and enjoying the variety of terrain that the trail offers. We loved the downhill blast into Paraha Valley and the old railway tunnel, which brought back memories of my first overnight camping trip as a five-year-old with Dad. The weather was perfect. Although we emerged into Karikari Beach, we had to battle against the sandstorm as the wind picked up and the sand stung our legs and eyes. Great fun. Finally, we made it off the beach and back onto the trails as we began the slow and steep climb out of Karikari towards Mercer Bay. It was at this point that we started to feel the burn of the 17 kilometres we'd run during another section of the trail only 2 days prior. It was also at this point that it started to rain. And when I say rain, I mean absolutely bucket down. It was awesome. I felt like Peppa Pig as I jumped in the muddy puddles as we ran along the short road section and then back into the bush for the final 5K. As a little aside, I actually work with Peppa Pig's auntie. Yeah, there you go.
Really?
Yeah. Her niece is Peppa Pig. Yeah. I think they had to retire though because you're getting a bit old, but she's minted, long story short. Yeah,
there you go.
That's good. Anyway, I was absolutely loving it and began to sing aloud as we ran. We were doing it. We were about to be, in the famous words of Sir Edmund Hillary, knocking the bastard off. As we turned off Piha Road and into the short descent down to Piha, I started to think about the finish and, more importantly, the incredible pies waiting for us at the Piha store. And he puts in parentheses, seriously, if you haven't had one, you should. As we raced down the hill towards Piha and those pies, the rain kept falling and parts of the track began to feel more like a stream. We arrived at what is usually a timid stream crossing at the top of Kitty Kitty Falls, where you can easily rock hop across to see that the stream was already quite high. We quickly assessed the situation and found a safe place to cross by grabbing hold of a few branches and made our way across with the water coming up to maybe our knees at the most, which is... that's quite a lot of water going through that part.
Going fast, yeah.
We continued on for another 5 minutes down a steep section of stairs and came to the bottom of Kitty Kitty Falls. Here the track usually crosses the stream at the bottom of the waterfall, although on this day there was no track. The falls were thunderous and it was obvious there was no way we could get across. It was incredible to see how much the stream, now river, had swollen considering it had only been raining for 20 minutes or so. We continued on downstream to look for another place that we might be able to cross. We arrived at a place that there used to be a small makeshift bridge, only to find that the bridge had been washed away. I realised at this point heading downstream was probably a bad idea, so instead we decided to head back up the same stairs we just run down with a plan in mind to cross again at the top of the falls and head back up towards the road. The pies would have to wait. When we got back to the same stream crossing that we had crossed maybe 15 minutes earlier, we were shocked to see that the stream, river, raging torrent had now risen by nearly 2 metres. The branches that we held onto to help us cross that were previously at head height were now almost underwater. Wow, there was no way we were going to make it across. Thankfully, at this point, my Bear Grylls survival instincts kicked in and I realised the only way to go was up. We didn't know exactly where to go, but I knew that there were some other tracks nearby that I'd never been on before but would likely take us uphill back onto Piha Road. At this point, we were both physically but probably more so mentally exhausted. The idea that we were so close to the car and to the end and most importantly to those pies, but yet we now had to turn and run in the opposite direction was just about too much. So instead of running, we walked up. Up and up and up. In the end, it was only about a 3K walk and 300-metre climb back to the road, but it took what felt like forever. Every now and then, we would stop and try and get hold of Alistair's then-pregnant wife, who was away. There's always that sting, eh? Your wife's, yeah. Got to get back for the birth of my child, who was waiting for us back at Piha to let her know where to meet us. We didn't have enough cell reception to call, but occasionally maybe got enough reception to send a text. I had my phone in a resealable plastic bag and it was near impossible to text, with every rain droplet touching the screen and making every text message incomprehensible. Eventually, we managed to send a few messages and explain that we would pop out on a track somewhere on Piha Road. We had no idea what it was called and so told her to check in each trailhead and car park along the road between Piha and Auckland. Wow, there's a few of them. When we did finally reach the road, it took her another 45 minutes to actually receive a text message and to get in the car to find us. So we sat there shivering on the side of the road, huddling under some trees, trying to stay warm, and there was no point trying to stay dry at this point, obviously. In the end, she eventually found us, and our 2.5-hour run turned into a 4.5-hour adventure. We never did get one of those pies, but the toasted sandwiches we had once we got back home tasted almost just as good. Turns out that it was a good thing we followed our noses and headed back up the hill. News reports came through that night saying 80 millimetres had fallen in just 4 hours. Roads were closed and people had to be evacuated from their homes further downstream from where we were. Apparently it was the worst flooding in 30 years. So there you go. That was my greatest and most adventurous run ever. I especially love it because now every time I drive to Pihar and drive past that trailhead where we emerge from the bush back onto the road, I'm reminded of that day and that epic little mission. I think the fact that the start of the trail is now boarded up due to Kauri dieback, like it's the entrance to a maximum security prison, and most of the Hillary trail is still closed, makes that memories of the day so much better. Cheers, Nathan.
Wow.
I love a bit of existential dread on a run.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, when you think about a decision, like, I'm glad they made the decision to climb up rather than try and cross that
Try and cross that river. Yeah, good call, good call. And that's the thing, is there's actually lots of sort of lessons in that, isn't there, of, you know, being sensible, checking the weather forecast. I don't know that I've checked many weather forecasts, actually, before heading out.
No.
In the Waitakere Range, so good on you for doing that. I'm also just thinking, too, at the end, I'm glad I always chuck an emergency blanket in my...
Absolutely.
Like, even when it's like I put it in there, often thinking, it's just extra weight. But you know,
yeah, I've always got mine on me.
It would be handy, wouldn't it? Yeah.
In my pack, not like now. But
I've got it now. Anyway, now to the rest of you, we really need some more greatest runs ever. Thank you, please, and thank you. Send them in. Seriously, do it.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Right, onto our show.
Let's go.
Kunal Kumar. Disclaimer, we love Kunal for who he is and his amazing photography. He's a trail runner. He's a photographer. He's a really good sort. We wanted to talk to him about his interests and passion, but also to pass on some tips. What's the secret to taking great trail running shots? This is a great conversation and we really enjoyed ourselves, partly because we got to catch up with him in person.
Fantastic.
And here's that conversation now.
Digit Radio.
So we're joined in person by Kunal Kumar. Kunal, welcome to Eugene's bedroom, or Dirt Church Radio Studios, as it is more eloquently known. It can be both things, but I mean, how are you, man? It's good to have you here.
Firstly, thank you for having me here in the DCR Studios / Eugene's bedroom. really honored to be here, and I'm a big fan of you guys and your work, so... It's really nice being on.
Awesome. I mean,
feeling is mutual.
Yeah, the feeling is
huge fan of you mutual. And your work. You know, it's remarkable.
And I mean, this is something that we've been talking about for such a long time. As you know, we see you at races. Your photography is really ubiquitous, and you're such an advocate for the sport. You're a participant. You know, I see you out at Riverhead all the time. You're doing races. But I mean, what first piqued your interest into, you know, this wonderful sport of trail running?
So just one person really that piqued my interest.
Who's that?
Jenny Hurst.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Jenny's responsible for me getting here, I guess, getting in Eugene's bedroom right now.
Well, actually, to clarify for the listeners, we're in the Dirt Church Radio Studios part of Eugene's bedroom.
Yeah.
Eugene's bedroom's massive.
There's demarcation lines.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So how did you meet Jenny, and how did that come about?
So Jenny and I used to work together. And I know she always used to say, and she was already a runner at that stage, and she used to organize all the runs at work, all the events, the Auckland Marathons and any other events, and put together the work teams. So she would keep at me to say, hey, why don't you join us for this half marathon or this event we're doing? And one day I signed up.
So for those who don't know Jenny Hurst and her husband Peter, I mean, they're absolute stalwarts. I think, you know, both in the Auckland scene, in New Zealand wide, they're always going to races. They're, you know, I just looked on their Instagram story before, you know, they did their 21st and 20th Auckland Marathon, the Wutu K, Tarawera. They're just everywhere. And everywhere you go, you know, they do the local Browns Bay critical mass runs.
That's right.
They're just such advocates for the sport. So you work together, and like everyone, you know, you see that person in the office, they've got muddy ankles, maybe they're a bit hungry, a bit tired on a Monday, and you decide to get into it. So where to from there? Were you already taking photos at this time?
It sort of came together at the same time. It's sort of intertwined, and I can't separate the two, the photography and the running. I've always sort of taken snapshots and of the family and all that sort of stuff. But about the same time, I decided to invest in a camera. And I started running at that time as well. And it was that first trail run when I was out there, and just the scenery just got me hooked. And so like, I think running was like a vehicle for me to take me to all of these places where I could take my camera and just enjoy the view and then take a few snapshots, really.
So even when you were running, you'd be conceptualizing shots and thinking about, you know, that would look really good, or that composition would look good, or would you go out and seek out a run to get a sunrise or to get a view?
I think initially it didn't really start out like that. It was just, oh, this is such a nice view, I'm going to snap it and post it or whatever and just enjoy it. But as the events rolled on and I started to do my own adventures, I definitely starting to do that a heap more, where I would just go out for sunrise, sunset. I've been known to pack the camera and a can of beer and say go out to the viewpoint at Tihanga and take a few snaps.
Nice. Like,
so yeah, it's definitely, yeah, like I said, it's like intertwined, and it's been really awesome.
Do you think that had your interest in photography, you know, do you think that you can separate them? Do you think that you would have kept up the running if it hadn't been for photography, or you'd have kept up photography if it hadn't been for running? Or do they go together so much?
I think, that's a real tricky question. Whenever I try to separate them, it doesn't quite, I don't feel right. And if I'm not running, I just don't feel like I'm taking good photos. And if I'm not doing photos, then my running doesn't seem to be feeling right. It's like I've got to seek an adventure, seek a sunrise, sunset, and take a few snaps at the same time.
Mm. Is it? Do you think it's because physiologically, if you're not running, you don't have that sort of, that sense of calm? Because I guess you have to, you know, taking a shot is, I guess it's both sort of planned, but there are moments of inspiration and something just happens. Yeah. So
it's, yeah. Yeah, definitely there's so many sort of unplanned moments. You know when you're out running that you might see something that nobody else is going to see at that point in time. A brilliant sunset, a kiraru flying by, bumping into your mates in the forest. it's definitely... provides that sort of motivation to get out and seek what's out there.
So what prompted you to buy the camera in the first place? Had you previously had much of an interest in photography apart from the family snaps that you talked about? Like, what was it that really got you thinking, this is what I want to do?
Yeah, it is just really the family snaps that I was doing previously. And at that time also, I think Instagram was coming up. And I think I had got some feature or something off a phone shot that I got on Instagram. And I thought, hey, you know, I kept my eye on some camera prices. And when the special came up, I was like, oh, I want to buy this and just see where it goes.
So had you, growing up, were you always the kid who was interested in taking photos? Is that has it always been part of who you are?
Yeah, definitely. And got to thank my dad for it as well. My dad was keen photographer. And he used to take lots and lots of photos. There's a whole box full of prints that we have at home. And so I think maybe that just flowed onto me. I just kept on taking photos, and that interest sort of just grew and grew.
Amazing, sort of a cross-generational difference though, hey, because your dad would have been shooting with a DSLR camera and on film, you know, and now we've got these cameras which are magnificent. I mean, I remember my first ever digital camera had a 2 megapixel lens. Yeah. I think it was 2 megapixel. I thought it was the most incredible thing ever. Gosh, now you know even in your phones. I mean, the cameras are fantastic. What do you prefer one medium over the other?
I haven't really shot a lot of film. It's only actually this year. Dad was cleaning out a few things at home, and his old camera is sitting there, and he said, "Do you want it? Do you want to have a play around with it?" And so I've just started really shooting film.
Wow.
What's that been like? See.
Yeah, it's been, I haven't developed the first roll of film yet. I haven't shot much. I think I've got like 10 shots in there at the moment.
Do you have to do that yourself? Are you going to do that yourself? Develop it yourself? Or
No, I don't. Yeah.
Did your dad do that, or did he take it for processing?
No, he took it to processing, right. I believe.
Yeah.
But maybe down the line, I don't know.
Yeah.
I've seen these YouTube guys who do their own developing and all that sort of stuff. Maybe.
Yeah, I in newsroom, when I started in newspapers, all the photographers did all their own developing. Wow. And so you talking about it, I can smell it. Like, you know, that smell comes back.
Yeah.
And thinking of going away on trips with photographers, and they'd have to set up a bathroom with, you know, blacking out the windows and everything, and blacking out the, you know, make sure no light got under the door or anything. And it's a whole other element to it.
It's a whole different world. And I've got photography friends who are really into it.
Yeah.
They've got lots of film cameras, the big Hasselblads, do the developing, prints and all that. And it's a different world almost.
Even the process of it, I mean, I think, I mucked around with one of my dad's old cameras back, you know, this is going back, you know, 25 years ago, and having to take things, you'd have to take things to Kmart, and if I was feeling particularly rich, you'd splurge on getting like a 1 hour development. You'd have to wait an hour for a film, and you had, what was it, how many, 20 on a...
24 or
36. Mm. 24 or 36. 24 shots.
Yeah.
And one or two might be good.
Yeah.
You know? And now we're in the age where, you know, we've got, I think, what have I got on my phone right now? I think I've got 2,000 photos in the cloud, you know? Like, it's madness dating back from years.
Yeah.
And you see these things on Instagram, you see these shots of these photographers, and they're so fantastic. But I guess you kind of perhaps, the point I'm trying to make in a very long-winded way is you lose the art and the eye that goes into making that shot. So people take some pretty shocking running photos. Myself included. You can say they do.
He's holding back a laugh. Listeners, he is holding back a laugh.
He's too modest. But look, I mean, one of the things that we wanted to get you on to talk about, because you're such a fantastic photographer, is what are the, if you were to, you know, and this is your chance, if I'm going out in the forest with my phone and going to take some photos of Eugene or Eugene, you know, what are some common mistakes that people make? And how do you take a good running photo?
No pressure.
No pressure at all. No, but I mean, I don't know. You know, we have coaches on here. We have other people, experts in their field. And now we're asking you. How? And it's Christmas. Everyone loves taking photos of themselves running, right?
Yeah.
How do you do it good?
Oh, thank you. I think the worst thing I see out there is blurry photos.
Right.
And this is because whilst we're running, we are moving, or whoever you're trying to take a photo of is moving as well. So the number one tip I guess I have is just stop. Whenever you're taking a photo, just stop. Stop for like 2 seconds and hit the shutter. And that's how you take a good photo.
Right.
That's a very important tip.
Yeah, yeah, stop.
Yeah. So, yeah, because what happens with when you're moving, and especially with our smartphones, which have smaller sensors than the bigger cameras, so they can't gather enough light into the sensor. So they will try to slow the shutter speed down, which will create more motion blur. So what you're trying to do is decrease that motion blur as much as possible. And so one way of doing that is to keep yourself still. So that's one component of it. And then you need good light. So if you can get your subject in good light, that means your phone will use a faster shutter speed. Therefore, your shots will be much sharper and probably nicer.
That's the thing about you. I mean, every time I see your photos, the light is the thing that really stands out. It's, I mean, your eye for that light. And I remember running with you once and you said, chase the light of taking photos. So is that a thing that you focus on? Are you always on the lookout for good light?
Yeah. Yeah. The light is definitely a key thing. And you ask most of the photographers out there as well, and they say it's all about the light. Photography is just all about the light. So you're always chasing, whether you're out there at sunrise or sunset, you want to chase that golden light, or you're doing some sort of portraits that you want a flattering light, whether you use artificial lights or whatever, a reflecting light. So the light is definitely a key component in that visually, sort of aesthetically nice looking shot.
And what constitutes good light? What are you looking for?
So for me, I love shooting out at sunrise and sunset. Because you get that really nice golden light, and that golden look in your photos. And in the direction that you're shooting it is as well. So, and you could use it either, you can use it to shoot against the light to create that sort of star sunburst sort of effect through the trees, or you can use it behind you to light up your subject and create that have a like a shadowy shadow look of that the light is creating.
So that's the thing, isn't it? I mean, midday is probably the worst time to take a photo, right? Just the sun is right above you, it's blazing, it's generally not a good time.
Yes, yeah, definitely. Midday is the sort of the more of the boring part of the day for photography, and it's not as pleasing when you take your photos. It's a quite a plain sort of white sort of a flat sort of a look.
So what are the top tips would you give for people, or as Matt kindly points it out when he was looking sideways at me, what are some examples of how not to take photos?
So I think you're actually drawing a bit of a long bow there, Mr. Bingham. I take a damn good photo.
I felt seen.
You take awesome photos. I love that the photo of the foot the other day.
Oh, yeah.
He dropped his phone. That's
okay, that's the story behind it.
I guess it's that thing, isn't it? Like, it's really good to hear, you say, just stop and take the photo. I fall into the trap as much as probably any other people of that whole thing of like, oh, this will be easy to plan the shot. And I end up running back and forth, you know, for like 10 or 15 minutes, buggering up every single shot and kind of wasting my time. So I just think I can't be bothered doing it. And I don't take very many photos anymore. Do you think, what am I trying to say? Is there a downside to everyone suddenly becoming an amateur photographer?
I don't think there's a huge downside. I love taking photos. I love other people taking photos as well.
Yeah.
Mm. And seeing their photos. If somebody else is encouraged by looking at my work, you know, I think that's awesome.
Fantastic.
That is, you know, it's fantastic that, you know, that they're doing it. They're out there. They're capturing the moment. They're absorbing the moment, being in the moment. It's brilliant.
Awesome. So it's like what I guess Zoe Rome said last week, a rising tide lifts all boats. So the more people engaged in the art, the better it's going to be for everyone.
Absolutely. If you're not hurting anybody, then...
Well, we had the first year that we ever ran Riverhead Rampage, a bunch of women came back in the forest, out of the forest, and they finished, and we were thrilled that they got back and they enjoyed it, and they're like, oh, it's great, and there was that photographer that you had in the bush. And we were like, no, we didn't have anyone taking photos in the bush, and there was someone out in the bush who was...
Okay.
Taking photos. Yeah. So that was,
Not good photos.
Well, I don't know. I haven't seen them. But it certainly wasn't affiliated with with our race. And it was quite worrisome, you know, that someone was out there unsolicited photos of people. What do you find? I mean, that must be a real art to it as well. Hey, because you're there at some moments, and I think about running or life, of great joy, great triumph, also great kind of despair, great distress. Is there an art to taking photos when someone is in pain or someone is really having a bad time and that might still make a compelling photo?
If they've specifically asked you not to take that photo, then I would definitely respect that and definitely not take it. And definitely there are people I run with and they say, hey, can you not take my photos? And I will not do that. In terms of like when a person is in a despairing moment, you know that's going to make a real good photo. One moment I think about is Adam Keane at last year's relapse, and it was his last lap, and on the course he was just really, really struggling, and his head was down, and he was just shuffling, and I was there. I was just like, oh, this, you know, I don't really want to take a photo, but this is just such a crucial moment. This is what, you know, if a moment that will evoke a emotion when seeing it. Head down, you know, out of it totally. I think, you know, in those sort of cases, it's really difficult, but for me, I would take that shot.
Yeah.
Because it's more about, again, you just not taking all of the good moments. Running is a lot about the bad moments. Absolutely. As well. Mm. A lot of the struggling, a lot of hurt, a lot of pain.
Definitely. And it's those moments that are more compelling, aren't they, really? I'd rather watch photos of people struggling than, you know, everyone like, yay, coming across the finish. And those happen can happen in the same kilometre, can't they?
Yeah, yeah.
And I mean, that's the thing. Your photos tell a story. They're not just snaps. They're often telling a story, and that's something that's really important to you too, isn't it? It's telling stories.
It's really important. I think that's the main driver for me. That old saying about a picture tells 1,000 words, but also taking that further in what I said before about evoking a emotion when seeing that photo, having that feeling of being there, what that person is feeling at that time, or if you capture this nice, beautiful sunrise, sunset or whatever, what it would feel like just being there and absorbing it all in and just enjoying it.
Mm.
And I think it does make it more than just a snapshot. I think there is definitely an art to it. So, yeah.
It's not pixels, it's people.
Absolutely.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah.
You mentioned relapse, and that's an event where you've captured some really stunning moments and photographs. It seems pretty, you know, I was going to say dear to your heart. I don't know if that's true, but it seems like it's really important to you. Is it? And what other events really, you know, excite you?
Yeah, definitely. Somehow, I think the relapse has just had a huge connection with me. And I think it just me being out in the forest a lot and then being asked to photograph the event as well just made the whole thing special, and just being connected to the place and the people and the whole event. It is a real special feeling.
Mm. I mean, it's an incredible event, isn't it? And I guess one of the advantages is you don't have to drive a whole bunch. Everyone's coming back. So I guess it's got that advantage from a photographic point of view in terms of logistics as well. And it's on, you know, for days.
Yes.
There's lots of moments.
Absolutely. That makes it a lot easier. It's close to home. And now me knowing that the trails quite well in Riverhead, it's easy to plan where I should be at what time to capture the moments. So,
and you do put that planning in, so you'll think, I need to be there at such and such a clock at time to get that sun at that moment and that sort of thing. Is that, you're going to that level of planning?
Absolutely, yeah. So last year I definitely went to that level of planning at what spot I wanted to be, where the sun would be, what sort of focal length I wanted. So what I would capture in terms of the runner, the trees, the light falling onto the trees, the environment they're in, what they're feeling. Definitely there is some planning involved in that. Yeah.
Mm. I mean, that environment, Barlow Road, coming up Barlow Road, I remember I checked the course at 6:30 in the morning on the Sunday, and you know, the sun was just peaking above the horizon and the mist was coming over the trees, and it's insanely beautiful. It's seared, I can remember, it's so redolent. I'm picturing it now as I'm talking to
Same.
You. Yeah, yeah. And it's but I guess it's having that, I wouldn't stop to think about how I capture that. I remember looking at it, but I think taking that photo and being able to translate that is a real skill. So my hat goes off to you, because it's that thing of when you look at like I might take a photo on my phone and go, that's brilliant, and then I still have the memory, but it's not representative of it, you know. But to actually capture a document that's so representative is a real skill. Who influences you in terms of your photography or your craft about marrying that up with going to races and ultras?
There are lots of there's lots of photographers, great sort of landscape photographers. One that comes off the top of my head is Thomas Heaton, who's he's an English landscape photographer. He would camp out in the mountains or the bushes for a sunrise or a sunset multiple days, just to capture a moment. he's definitely one of my favorites. I've got one of his photo books at home. So he's definitely a huge inspiration in terms of just pure photography. But a lot of runners are definitely influential to me as well.
Yeah.
Because I just see just some of the places that the runners are going, the mountains, the forests, the beaches, and that's a huge inspiration to me to get out there and capture similar things. One thing that comes up to me, you guys last week talked about Steve Neary. Mm. 4 years since he passed away, and he was one such person that was a huge inspiration to me. I still remember that photo that he took at the top of Old Ghost Road, the Heaven's Door photo. It's just so awesome. And he used to send me photos from like the Hanua Ranges and stuff like that. And yeah, that was a huge inspiration for me. Mm. Yeah.
I mean, you got to hand it to Steve. He was ridiculously photogenic. Yeah. I mean, I don't think I ever saw a bad photo of the man. And, and you know, his form and everything like that, just utterly stunning. And then he went through his morph suit period where he'd wear that.
Oh, yeah.
He sort of stopped racing as competitively and he'd just chase people in that sort of nightmarish full body suit that he used to wear that used to terrify people. All right, so Steve Neary, what in terms of your running, what do you like to do the best? I mean, do you have any races that really sing to you, or what's your favorite type of running?
Trail running is definitely my favorite type of running. I really haven't focused on a race for about 3 years now, seriously. And I'm not sucking up to you here, but my major race this year was the Riverhead Rampage.
Oh.
And then that's the only event I've done this year as well. And I had a time goal there and I achieved it. And yeah, so I'm not really looking out to races these days, but more just personal adventures and keeping myself fit.
But you're always there and thereabouts. I mean, you popped down to Tarawera. It was a lovely, lovely surprise. When I got to Rerefakaiatu, I think it was,
yeah,
and there's Kunal. and it was a lovely surprise. I wasn't expecting to see you. So you're always, I mean, I guess you're always thinking of events in terms of moments and adventures and photographs as well. They're not just races.
Yeah. So, yeah, in that terms, yeah, maybe I would like to go to races to observe or take a few photos like that. Yeah, definitely. And Tarawera this year was one like that. There was so many of my friends, yourself as well there. And it's just being in that moment and the environment.
Mm.
It's just such a buzz to be there.
Yeah,
it is that thing, isn't it? And I think everyone who's listening, who's been at a race or been at an event, there is something that's so much more than the sum of its parts, right? Like if you think you bunch of people at a race and some people win and some people don't, everyone gets muddy, they go home. Okay. You know, but it's just such a, there is an electricity to it, isn't there? That's really hard to beat.
Absolutely. It's infectious.
Yeah. And it's humanity writ large, isn't it? I mean, those moments that you talked about, of pain, of joy, of, you know, somebody who's beat up bad, but who gets through it. You see all of humanity at a race, don't you?
It's very real.
Yeah.
It's very real.
Yeah. So just back to your own running, what was your, you know, so when Jenny signed you up, had you had any involvement running before? Had you done any running previously or?
No.
Wow. Yeah.
It's pretty much like outside of school PE classes. Yeah. Like I've never been involved in any other sort of running.
Yeah. Were you a sporty kid or anything? Or?
Not. I played a little bit of cricket, high school cricket,
mm-hmm.
but that was it. Not too sporty at all. never really into running.
Yeah.
Never really watched the sports from afar either.
So how on earth did Jenny convince you? I mean, she's a convincing person.
Jenny is a convincing person and really good at that. I think it was probably just that stage of life or something that I was in at that time. And I said, the hell of it. Let's sign up, see what happens.
Yeah. Do you remember what your first event was?
The first event was the duel.
Wow.
Oh, whoa.
What was it, the marathon?
No.
No.
I did the 10K.
Oh, that's enough. I mean, the duel, that's no joke, that, right?
It's no trot around the block.
No, it's not.
No, yeah. The duel, I have to say, that really got me hooked into onto trails and the whole photography part of things. It sort of clicked in my head. Oh, I can be out here at these beautiful trails and take photos as well. So I think it was just that clicking moment that I had there.
I mean, it's photogenic, the way to describe a race, but it's a photogenic race, isn't it?
It is.
It's
beautiful.
It's beautiful. It is. Yeah. And you did run the marathon there, didn't you?
I have, yeah.
Yeah?
I have.
Was that, how long between, you know, how long after you started did you do the marathon?
Oh, was it maybe 4 or 5? So, yeah, I did upgrade to the half marathon, I think a couple of years later, and then the marathon a couple of years later. So it must be about 4 or 5 years later that I've done the marathon.
I think we did it the same year.
Yes.
Yeah.
Myself,
Jenny, and Dave Jack. Yeah. It was Dave's first marathon.
Ah.
And Kunal and Jenny and the crew were there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Did he sing Scoria as well?
No, that was
that
me.
That was just you?
Or maybe he chimed in, but certainly I was annoying enough for everyone. But in terms of that race as well, like, it's, again, like some total sport events, they're really quite underrated. You think about if you take a dip on some of those trails, you're not getting back up with the score. It's like dragon glass out of Game of Thrones, isn't it? I mean, you just, it's going to cut you open.
That coastal trail, yeah.
It's
and you, I don't know if I've seen multiple people get cut up on.
No, I haven't.
I've like just full of huge gashes and stuff. So
yeah.
I ran along that with a psychiatrist who I've known for sort of 20 years, and we were just reflecting how poorly someone's luck would be to dip in front of us and really hurt themselves. And you'd have a doctor, and I'm doing air quotes, and a nurse with you. But all we could think about is, you know, how are you feeling? You know, it's like, I have no practical help, and she's probably not much better. Sorry, Lindsay, if you're listening to that, but it's true. That race, I mean, it's a difficult race.
It is, yeah.
Do you, I mean, we're sort of, you know, we're at that period of time where we're not going anywhere very fast. And this year has been the year of cancelled events. But is there anywhere around the world that you would really like to get to either run or take photos?
So Patagonia is definitely one place I want to go, both for the trails and the photography. From what I've seen, it just looks so awesome.
Yeah.
That's number one on my list.
Yeah. It's a stunning. I mean, everything I've seen is just amazing. So
Yeah.
Yeah. What about in New Zealand? Are there any, what missions have you got planned?
South Island, I definitely want to go back to the South Island a lot more and do those missions, those trails. I feel like I haven't done a lot of the South Island. Mm-hmm. So, I definitely want to, Queenstown, Wanaka, Tekapo, Mount Cook, and all the trails that are all around there as well. So
it's so different, isn't it? You don't, like, you might think like, oh, this, you know, this Waitakere sunrise is fantastic, and all running the Tehenga Trail, and you look down and, you know, the water's glinting and everything. But if you're up in the hills, up in the proper mountains in the South Island, it's just something else.
Yeah It's just stunning.
All right, I'm going to take it around to a really base level now.
Okay.
Kunal, How do you take a good selfie?
I'm not the selfie expert.
Have I just insulted you? He's walked out. Oh, my God, he's gone.
I'm out of here.
But you do take good selfies. So how? What's the secret?
I think it's
Well, I won't say that. You don't take good selfies. You usually grab other people in them as well.
Yeah, so they're great.
You're getting group photos, but you just happen to be in them as well. So what's the best way to do that? What's the key?
Go as wide as you can.
Have longer arms.
Yeah, either if you can have long arms, or with some of the new smartphones, they have a wider angle on the front camera. So that is, I feel, a much better selfie or a group photo, and if you can get the environment around you.
And so you're holding the phone like that with the front camera, or are you doing it that way?
Front camera, yeah.
So proper big boy camera.
Oh, no, no.
Oh, that's the back camera?
That's the back camera.
This shows you how much I know about cameras. Front camera, the screen. Facing,
yeah.
Oh, fantastic.
So because you still want to get your framing right.
Ah, okay. And how then, high do you go? I'm
like
holding my cell phone up.
This is making excellent podcasting.
Like a 10-degree angle up.
There we go. That's good. That's good. The professional.
So arm's length.
10-degree angle.
Longer arms, the better.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and make sure you get your best side.
Okay. I mean, so I mean, I'm of the generation. I mean, I take the odd selfie, but I do feel a little bit self-conscious about it. And then you go into an environment. Again, I guess it comes down to that thing about, like, take a photo a week later, take it to the photo booth, get it developed. It's so instantaneous, isn't it? And you see people taking selfies, unselfconsciously taking selfies in the most self-conscious places.
Yeah.
And it must admit, it does my head in a little bit. Because it's a different generation, isn't it?
It is.
Did you just call yourself old?
Oh, I'm dating myself. Absolutely. I mean, it's...
the other thing too is that, I mean, I find myself, I'll take photos most often on my phone. Suzanne's the photographer in our house, so her camera has stunning photos on them, and she'll print them out and so on and make use of them. But most of my photos just stay on my phone. And when I was thinking of you with your dad with the box of photos, that's a really special moment that we're not going to have. Nobody's going to go, oh, look, there's Dad's old phone. Let's go through it.
Wonder what's in the cloud.
Yeah.
You know, we're losing something, aren't we, with that digital photography?
Absolutely. And printing them is a key thing. Print your photos, every month or
whatever. So you do that?
I do that, yeah, absolutely. I've started a photo wall in my home, and I try to, that's my sort of thinking, to do every month, to try to print as many photos or the best shots I can.
So take the best ones, get them printed. Do you do it? How do you do it? Do you send it off somewhere or?
Yeah, just what do you do? I've in the past I've had one friend who's had a printer before, so I've done it through that. But now I use photoprints. .co.nz. There's another person I know there. I do the prints there, but. Or you don't have to go to a professional printer. Just go down to your local Harvey Norman warehouse stationery, whatever, and get the.
But get them printed out.
Get them printed.
And display them.
And display, yeah, absolutely, yeah. Mm. Display them somewhere. Have a photo book, photo wall.
Yeah.
I think it's really important.
Yeah.
It seems like so much more of a social thing too. Like if I was to go round to your house or go downstairs out of the studio to Eugene's lounge reception hall, and he was sat there looking at his phone and looking at photos, or I was doing it, that seems quite antisocial. But if there was a book of photos and I was we were sitting there looking at them together, that's a much more kind of social thing to do, isn't it?
Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely more social.
Well, we're going to have to double up on our last questions, I think.
Okay.
We'll go with the regular, and then I've got an extra.
Okay. Right. Well, do you want to do the extra first?
Do the extra first. All right. I'm trying to formulate it. I was going to go with the other one first, but Kunal, what is your greatest running photo ever? And it doesn't have to be
one he's best. In or one he's taken.
No, one you've taken. Your favorite of all time running photo. Tell us about it. Tell us about how you got it and why it's your favorite.
So my greatest photo ever, it involves you and you, ooh. Eugene and Matt. Turning the tables here. it's that photo of the sunrise at the Trig.
Ah.
With you, Eugene, and Tom running.
Yeah.
I'm not in that one. I went home.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Oh, no, yeah. That's, what was that? We met you at the Trig.
And I was like weeping into my hands because I had such a bad run. And then I saw all you guys. I was like, I'm going to go now. And just like cry ran back to the car.
That is an amazing run. That is an amazing photo.
It was an amazing run as well. It was one of my first runs with you guys out in the forest. I wasn't too, at that time I wasn't really familiar with the forest too much and not run with you. But maybe it was my second run or something with you guys. And that was a really, really awesome moment. I remember, and I haven't seen that sort of light.
Yeah.
Through the trees, and there was a foggy mist around.
Yeah, it must have been about 7 o'clock or something.
It was, yeah.
Yeah.
It's just like right after sunrise, sort of. And yourself and Tom were just running up the hill. The others are also in the photo, just lined up, sort of going in further. And then the sun is just bursting through the trees in the background.
Yeah.
And that just, that golden light, and I think it just captures everything.
So how did, you were running with us.
Yeah.
You didn't have your camera with you, did you?
No.
It was just on the phone, right?
Don't give up the secret.
You apparently just stopped running, Eugene. I'm not looking at the photo now. I mean, like,
it's a cracker.
It's super good.
Where can people see it? They can see it.
It's our header on our Facebook page, and it is just fantastic.
It's amazing. Yeah. So I'm interested in the sort of logistics of that. So you were running with us, and I mean we were all running. None of us went, oh wow. But did you see it straight away for what it was, or did you just happen to take it? Or
I think a mixture of both.
Yeah,
I saw. I think we come around that corner.
Yeah. Because it's up at the Trig, isn't it?
Yes, it's very near the Trig,
on
the gravel road going up, and I saw there's lots of mist around, and the sun has just come up, and so this might make a good photo. I don't know. I had my phone out.
Yeah.
And I stopped.
Number one.
Stopped. And the perspective. So another one, I guess, one tip is you could use different perspectives. So I did kneel down on that photo to get more of a looking up shot. So I got you guys both in the foreground there, but also I was able to capture all of the trees and the whole sunrise in the background there.
And it's a very wide shot, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if that's the right word, right? Yeah. Term, but.
So I think, and you can use the perspective to make it wider. So if you go down lower, sort of creates a wider field of view as opposed to just at eye level or pointing it downwards.
Yeah, yeah.
Sort of closes the shot a little bit more.
And then when did you know, straight away, oh yeah, that's a good photo, or was it later on when you were going through your phone or camera? When you were developing the film.
When you'd been to Kmart and dropped it off and said $7 1 hour service, please.
When you had your box brownie and you unpacked it. When did you recognize it for what it was?
I think at the time I'd known I hadn't looked at the photos straight off. But at the time I felt like, oh, I think I might have a good photo here.
Yeah.
And then sort of going home after that and seeing that and giving it a bit of an edit and like, oh, wow, this is really stunning. I really like that one.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's amazing. And those trees aren't there anymore.
Yeah.
So that really captures a moment in time. That's never, I mean.
No one else can ever get that.
That's never going to happen again.
So don't go out to Riverhead at 7 o'clock on Sunday morning because you won't get that photo. You have to chase your own light.
No,
but
yeah.
Does it, so what, when you see that, do you get, you know, butterflies in your stomach? Do you, like, what happens for you personally when you know you've got a really good shot?
Yeah, definitely butterflies in the stomach and, like, just being really happy,
yeah,
you know, with myself. Like, oh, yeah, I was able to capture actually something good today.
Yeah.
And, yeah, that's one of the photos that I have on the photo wall. And I see it every day in my home office, so, yeah.
All right, well, part two. Kunal, what is your greatest run ever? And you know this question comes, so you've got no excuses.
I had a suspicion this question was going to come. So thinking about it, had lots of really good adventures with friends, with you guys, together. But there's one event at 1 year that really sticks out, and we've sort of actually talked about it already. Mm-hmm. The 2017 dual marathon sort of ranks above everything personally for me, as being, I feel like, one of my greatest runs. So I was doing the marathon. I think it might have been the first year I've done the marathon there. And just everything felt great that day. Everything felt like it was working. I didn't feel like I died at the 30K mark like I usually do. There was no nutrition issues. There was no issues with the body. I was running really happy. I was taking lots of photos. That was definitely a key. I took a couple of selfies with the Total Sports staff, Mark and Wiki, who were out there. So I felt like I was really enjoying myself that day. But I was actually also running really well.
Mm.
I couldn't believe it. I was really running well. I was passing people at the back end of it on the last 10Ks, and still running, so no real walking apart from the hills, and I finished way earlier than I had expected, and so that moment just was like, just that wow feeling that I don't know, that everything almost went right, and like, wow, this is how it feels when everything goes right and the body's feeling great and everything's feeling good and you finish so good. That was definitely, I feel like, one of my greatest runs.
That's beautiful. It's like the perfect photo, really, isn't it? So difficult, like easy to think about,
yeah,
and difficult to actually pull
off.
Yeah,
you conceptualize it. You know what it should look like, but very rarely does it actually come off. You're right. Yeah.
And what I love, and just to sort of finish up, thank you, what I love about what you've expressed is it seems like you've resisted or had the kind of the wherewithal, and I speak for myself, I've fallen into that trap of wanting to chase races and chase experiences and be in the herd and do it and put myself against myself and kind of that pressure. You've just expressed that for the last 3 years you've gone, I'm actually going to do my own thing and have the enjoyment come from, it's almost that intrinsic enjoyment rather than chasing a goal or chasing a time. It's really it's refreshing to hear, actually, because so many people, I think, and it's almost that my own question for people, and I kind of stop myself if I see someone out running. I go, what are you training for? Do you have to be training for anything?
Yeah, I feel like it's really, that is really, really important, and especially this year.
Absolutely.
When things have been cancelled left, right and centre, you got to have that internal energy, passion and drive to still get out there and not just rely, I think, on a race or a time or a goal or whatever.
You find your own challenges, don't you?
Absolutely.
Like running every street or every public space east of your house and then doing it, posting it on Strava, feeling really proud until someone points out that you missed somewhere. Wonder. And then you have to go back and do it again.
Oh, yeah, that was Kunal.
I wonder who that someone was.
But thank you, because I did discover a really beautiful little place that I didn't know about, so there we go.
Imagine like having a talent like taking photos and using it just for revenge.
Wonderful. Thank you so, so much for joining us. Kunal. And we'll better get back to those Diwali snacks. Thank you so
Absolutely.
Much.
Absolutely. Thank you, brother.
Happy so Diwali.
Thank you for having me on.
Your selfie action is going to be amazing this summer, Matt.
I'm going to grow my arms. I think that's the plan.
Yep.
I do feel a bit self-conscious about it. I feel like I'm a bit old, if we're being honest. I feel like my 30s, all right, selfie game is okay. 40s, I'm just not.
What a great conversation. Thank you, Kunal. It was like, I love the depth.
Yeah, the depth and the he's considered, so he's kind and thoughtful. Yeah. Absolutely. Fantastic. Look, thank you, Kunal, and thank you all very much for tuning in. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio, and you can email us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. You can find us on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, and other podcast platforms. And you can download it direct from the website, which is dirtchurchradio.com. Also, if we're not where you want us, let us know. Don't forget to subscribe and rate us. And if you like what you see, spread the love. It would be as great as if many people heard the show as possible, and for that, we need your help.
Don't forget to write in with your greatest run ever. We'd love to hear from you, and we enjoy them in all their different forms.
Absolutely. I'm still giggling about that one. When did you get traumatized? I'd like to read it actually back with that voice now that I've been talking all day. That's just that deep.
Yeah.
I was in a pickle. Thanks to our sponsors, Scott Running for the Faster and Spring Energy and Cielli. And thank you to our Patreon patrons and Wild Things. Thanks to our editor, Kieran. And we've got a great guest lined up for you next week. So tune in then. Ka kite.
Ka kite.
Also, Karere was robbed.
And the spotted kiwi.
Robbed.
Thanks, Rigby.